nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
First item today is the public hearing on the waiver of administrative class cap. Take the roll, please.
Collins?
Here.
Childers?
Here.
Bessler?
Here.
Lee?
Here.
Owen?
Here.
Sullivan?
Here.
Here. Mary?
Here.
Take us through these.
This evening, we are having a hearing on requesting a waiver for the administrative class cap for the 2015-16 school year. In the state of Illinois, we have certain functions that the state classifies as administrative. One of them is other building administrations, which our department chairs fall under. Even though we are down two department chairs this year, we have changed the number of courses taught by the department chairs from 2 to 1, which puts them back at the 2010 level before we made our major reductions. We believe that this is necessary for them to do an effective job with the teacher evaluation program. We have published notice in the journal and topics of the public hearing in a timely manner within the time stated in the waiver request. We have provided the information posted on our website at least 2 weeks in advance of tonight's meeting. And now we open it up to any public comments on the administrative class cap waiver that there might be.
Are there any comments? Hearing none, thank you very much. A motion to adjourn the public hearing. Second?
Second.
Third? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Call to order the public hearing for the purpose of the fee waiver application for driver's education fee. Please take the roll, please. Childers?
Aye.
Owen?
Here.
Sullivan?
Lee?
We are just a call.
Okay.
Oh, here. Lee?
Here.
Bessler? Collins?
Here.
McGrath?
Here.
Oh, the meeting. This is for the driver.
Right.
The application for driver's education. Mary, again, please.
I'll take this one.
Okay.
So this is a public hearing of, for our fee waiver application for driver's ed for our district. Driver's ed, as you know, is mandated for us to offer from Indiana School Code. And we need to request a waiver for 5 years, which we did the last time around, in order to have the fee be able to go up to $500. We've never charged that before, but application allows us to have that language in case we need to charge that amount currently. It's $350 that we charge. Board has to keep that amount every year, so we see that fee coming forward. And the current amount that it costs us to offer the driver's ed is about $113 per student. So the district is currently subsidizing about triple the fee anyway. But this is just something we do every 5 years. It's an application that we have to file for the year. So we're bringing it before the board to state for the citizens who wish to speak to this and suggestions.
And Mary, this was published in the paper?
Published in the paper, posted on the website. All of the requirements with the waiver have been met.
Are there any public comments on the waiver? Hearing none, is there a motion to adjourn the public hearing?
A second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you very much. Now call to order the regular regular board meeting. Can you stand up here? I'd like to take the roll, please. Sullivan?
Owen?
Here.
Collins?
Here.
Lee?
Here.
Childers?
Here.
Bessler?
McGrath?
Here. We will start with 207's Best Award for Community Service. First, we make Maine East, Mike.
Nary, our student, is trying to get across the tracks.
Okay. We will reorder from
from Maine South, Josh Ramirez.
I'd like to introduce Jessica Hoffman, so if we can stand, Jessica. She's 207's best from Maine South for Community Eastern. So Jessica, you could say, is maybe the typical teenager when you look at her, but she's a pretty extraordinary young lady. Once you get to know her, you know she has a dedication to service to others, and in this case, it's not just service to those with 2 feet. A little bit more about that as I talk about her. She's very active at school in various organizations, specifically Key Club, where she's helped in soup kitchens and Marriott pad shelters. She's a member of the National Honor Society, where she gives back as a peer tutor. She devotes many hours practicing and competing as a member of our gymnastics team, because she's a pretty well-rounded student. She takes some AP classes like calculus and chemistry, which makes some sense, and she's headed down the path, I think, to veterinary science, so very important to her future career. But it goes without saying that she's a serious student, and tonight it's about the passion that she has for serving others. She makes things happen. One of the first major endeavors she undertook was to help found Park Ridge Friends at the Park Youth Advisory Board. And this group seeks to rejuvenate our existing parks, acquire new park lands, and preserve green space, and develop innovative recreational programs. And she actually helped to conceive and implement their very first fundraiser, which is now their yearly cornerstone fundraiser, which is, make sure I get this correct, Pedal for the Park's Used Bike and Trike Sale. So you bring in your used tricycles and bikes, and they sell them and then use that money to support the parks. In addition to that, it helps bring out people to the Earth Day Fair. So each year on Earth Day, you can travel to one of the parks in Park Ridge. I'm sorry, I forget the exact one. But it's a great way to keep things out of landfill and give money back to the parks. Also, she has a passion for those in our lives of different species, animals, dogs in particular. She worked extensively with Paws of Chicago as a volunteer. Paws is a no-kill shelter, and Jessica has fostered over 50 abandoned and abused dogs, some of which require late nights helping to deliver puppies, as I learned. A mom and 5 puppies, I think, we discussed when we talked a little bit about that. She actually, one of the puppies she fostered was adopted by Hoda Kotb, live on the Today Show about a year ago. So her commitment to the quality of life of animals has led her to explore a career in veterinary medicine, and she was accepted to both summer high school veterinary programs at Tufts and Cornell Universities.
Wow.
For her work in this area, Jessica has been given the 2014 Youth Community Service Star Award by the Park Ridge Chamber of Commerce and was named the 2014 Paws of Chicago Volunteer of the Year. But Ms. Sinclair, a dance teacher, I think sums up some important things that we all feel about Jessica. Jessica Altman demonstrates compassion and empathy that is rarely seen to this extent in a high school student. Her desire to help ease the suffering of living creatures speaks volumes about her character. These traits make her a quiet leader that earn her deserved respect from her peers. It's people like Jessica that can make a difference in our world. So with that, I give you Jessica Altman. With you, or what are your plans?
I would like to thank Mr. Mesmer, Dr. Wallace, Ms. McGrath, and the rest of the board, and the faculty who nominated me. I would also like to thank my family for all the support they have given me throughout everything, especially the insane idea of fostering over 50 dogs. From 3 a.m. barkings to 4 a.m. smelly gifts to 5 a.m. births, they have happily embraced it all, as I'm sure you can imagine. I'd also like to thank the dogs for the life experiences they have given me. watching the first breath of a puppy, watching the last breath of a dog, and all the wet kisses in between. I would like to move on and become a critical care veterinary medicine, and my dream would one day be to go back to Paws, but not as a foster, as their own veterinarian.
Very cool.
All right.
She has such a spirit of giving that to receive something is a little difficult. love you already, but I'm going to say nice things about you, Megan. And her social science teacher is also here, Mr. Harper, and I'm going to share some things that he has said about her because she's done a lot of work with him and voice for the movies. So Megan is a ridiculously talented young lady with a 4.57 GPA who just works her tail off in any attribute of the school that you can think of, but mostly in giving service to others. She's really a powerhouse in our school community, but also in the community outside of Maine West. One of the neatest things she does is gets involved with the group Voice for the Nameless, where she has taken on a spring break trip planning of a spring break trip to Georgia, and I'll tell you about that in a little bit. But the other thing she does, and then I'll talk to you about her service. She's captain and member of Orchesis for 4 years. She's the drum major and member of the marching band. She's captain, pole vaulter, and member of the track and field team. So she's involved in so many different areas and is such a well-rounded student. She's worked with Inspiration Corporation. She goes 1 to 2 times per month, and they cook and serve meals to the guests who are there in a restaurant style so that they can, people who are homeless can go there and get a dignified meal if they're in a restaurant. She also helped plan their Christmas party. She's worked with Bridge Kids, which is an organization within the Bridge Community Church. She goes 2 to 3 times per month helping students there and teaching younger children. She's volunteered several times at Feed My Starving Children, where she packages meals for South Korea and Haiti. She's worked with the Kids Pantry, helping sort through their lost and found donations and help set up one of their largest giveaways ever. She's also helped to coordinate, and this is the trip that she's planning for spring break, to Friends of Refugees in Clarkston, Georgia, where they are tailoring their trip to meet with students, tutor students, help with kids who are needy, and just do activities with these kids for a week long. Instead of taking a break like most kids will do, she'll be out there with a group of kids, helping the less fortunate than herself. She really takes an active role in that group Voice for the Nameless and has probably taken more of an active role than any other student who's a part of that group. Whenever there's an activity, you can count on Megan being there. She really wants to make a difference in the world and plans to be a pediatrician. And one of the things, I'm going to share with you what Mr. Harper has written about her. He says, "I've never known a person who brings so much warmth and caring into all she does. When I think of her current career of choice, a pediatrician, I think of all the children who will be so fortunate to have her for a doctor, someone who will bring care and compassion to every aspect of her practice, from the minute those children walk in her door. She makes everyone around her better because everything she does is marked by a smile and an excellence of effort. She's already made a difference in her world, and she'll make a difference on the college campus she'll call home next year, as she prepares to make a difference in the world of pediatrics or whatever career path she ultimately chooses. She's learned how to be resilient, and I'm confident she'll pass this vital quality on to others both in word and in action. She's a can't miss." Megan really has made a difference in the world of community service and has showed other kids in that group and at Maine West how it's done. We're really proud of her and all she's done at Maine West, so congratulations, Megan.
For their support. They really inspired me to become a bigger better person and reach out. So thank you and all of you.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Maine East's nominee selection for community service 207's best, Neri Patel. I think this may be the, well, I don't want to use the term flustered because I don't think that quite fits, but this is, Neri is probably the most put together student that I've ever.
Sorry about that.
Let me tell you a little bit about Neri. I think just to preface before we start, you know, there are times you maybe if you would think about like a great photographer or an artist or something, and it would be dealing with groupings of very, very important people and very, very important events throughout history. Neri might not be like that primary focal person, but she would be like the right next person looking over the shoulder in multiple of those settings and contexts. She's really risen to her own in terms of that leadership and then that service, but she has been consistently, for her entire career at Maine East, one of the people who has been very quiet, and I used the term last month, and it is very applicable again. She's really a servant leader in the way she goes about doing things. So while in Interact, particularly in DECA, and some of the things we're going to talk about, we've had some very, very strong, you know, force of will sorts of personalities. That is not Neri's MO in terms of the way she gets things done. She again, is always very, very poised in terms of the way she goes about things. She's very well organized. She is able to delegate and coordinate and to orchestrate, and for that reason has been very successful and I think is enjoying a good year. She's got a GPA of 4.81, so clearly she does a pretty nice job academically in the classroom. Again, taking a lot of AP and accelerated coursework. She's also a very active member of Gifted Lyceum. She's been on the service trips, went to Ohio, particularly warm work trip this last year, and has been involved in various activities and the outreach they do there. She's also enrolled in our Project Lead the Way Civil Engineering and Architecture. She's a senior leader in PE, so she's availed herself of a lot of academic offerings. In addition to all of this, she's been a three-year member of my principal's leadership team. She's a member of the National Honor Society. She's president of the school's Rotary Interact Club, which is, I think, approaching 300 members now. It's the largest organization at East and the largest in the state, and has seen another uptick under her leadership this year in terms of kind of tail twisting to get people involved. She's vice president of student council. She's vice president of DECA. She's one of two students responsible for serving as the voice of Maine East on morning announcements, which she's done for the past 3 years. And she volunteers at the Niles Public Library and the Belmont Retirement Home, and she works at teller at a local bank. So she does quite a lot. As a member of the DECA chapter, she has presented and participated at both the state and national levels. Last year, her team was one of three finalists with their design of a waste management model. She has managed the planning and staffing of our D&M Depot for past years and over the summers, which is supply, getting supplies, making sure we've got things, coordinating people who are going to work in the depot. She's also been in charge of coordinating the staffing for our D&M Brew program that gives some of our transitional program students the opportunity to work side by side with some other Maine East students. And it's been sort of a project that's been taken under the wing of Rotary and the Interact chapter. So National Honor Society, she was really shouldered a lot of responsibility last year for the Color Walk that raised $2,500 for Muscular Dystrophy Association. And again, really led by example in that venture. In terms of the Interact chapter, you know, we've done some good work in the past, and Neri's been very involved with that. As later this year, she's really set the bar. So where last year we raised about $10,000 with Interact for the WGN toy drive, she set a goal of $15,000, and we're going to go for it and see how we do here. In terms of we had an End Polio Now program for Rotary International, and last year initiated a dodgeball tournament school-wide that raised $3,700. And this year, I should say about 500 students, so this year we're shooting for $7,000 and about 1,000 students, which It's a whole lot of dodgeball that gives me a little concern. I'm sure it's very well supervised, so. But again, her Rotary has mantra of service above self, and I think that Mary really sleeps, eats, breathes, walks that as she goes through. She's just intelligent. She's a great work ethic. She's has a good common sense, positive attitude. She's diligent. She needs to get the job done quietly with style. Aneri is your person to go to. So we are extremely proud of you, and know you're going to do great things in the future. Congratulations.
So first, I have Mr. Foley, my previous physics teacher. I have a Charlotte. She's a Rotarian. We work with her in Rotary Interact. Also, Mr. Al Martel, who's also another Rotarian. Miss Ballow, who helps me with announcements every morning and is the sweetest person I've ever met. And of course, Mr. Schwann. I really would not. I have no words for everything Mr. Schwann has done throughout all 4 years. I met him my freshman year, and ever since, he's helped mold me and helped me become the leader I am today. Really, I would like to thank everybody for everything they've done for me. And I have applied to a bunch of schools, waiting on responses, so I'm not exactly sure where I would be going, but I applied for chemical engineering with the hopes of eventually working for the EPA and maybe going to get an MBA eventually.
This time we'd like the 2007 best recipients and the special schools to step out in the hallway for a picture. And this is your chance to take off from the board meeting if you so choose.
Congratulations. I know Todd very well. In less than an hour, as I cover this morning. This is pre-game show.
Next on the agenda are public comments. At this time, I have two cards from people who wish to speak to the board tonight. Thank you very much for taking your time to come here tonight. And we only ask that you limit your remarks to 3 minutes. First is Janet, and I'm going to murder your last name. Keskowski?
Yes.
Please, thank you.
My name is Janet Kachowski, and I live in the Main East Attendance area. I'm here to make a request regarding my daughter. My daughter started bowling in a league and taking lessons in fifth grade. During the 2010-2011 school year, the Illinois Elementary School Association held the first state elementary bowling tournament. My daughter's elementary school allowed her and several students to compete. She finished in 30th place. The following year, she finished 18th. As a Main East freshman, she researched starting a bowling club. Her sophomore year, she and fellow bowling students started one. Several members of the club competed in the 2013-2014 Illinois High School Association bowling tournaments for boys and girls. After successfully competing in sectionals, my daughter and two male students made it to regionals. The student she started the club with made it to state, finishing 83rd. My daughter became ill soon after that and was out of school for several months. Her junior year was spent regaining her strength and returning to school. In the time she was out of school, the club lost its sponsor due to changes in his schedule. The other student tried and was unable to find another sponsor. He graduated last year. My daughter is now a senior. She found a teacher to sponsor her for this year's bowling tournament. She and the teacher submitted a request for approval to participate in the tournament. They received a response denying the request. The response stated that the district schools will not be participating because of costs to the district and that this decision was made last year. My daughter said to me, "I just wanted the opportunity to participate." I contacted Jason Lambert, Assistant Executive Director of IHSA. I shared the situation with her and asked what options we had. Her response was, if the school doesn't enter her, there is no way for her to enter. IHSA rules only allow schools to enter athletes into IHSA state series tournaments, so you have to get your school to agree to enter her. I am here tonight to ask you to allow my daughter to participate in this year's IHSA girls bowling tournament. And although the deadline for participation was yesterday, Ms. Lambert said that they typically have late entries. As long as late entries are received in the next few weeks, it's usually not a big deal. It's frustrating and disrespectful that after allowing students to participate for 1 year in a state bowling tournament, the district turned around the next year and said no. There were requests last year and this year from students at each of the main schools to participate in state bowling tournaments. I understand that there is a cost to the district. This cost is not ridiculous. For each student participating in sectionals, the cost is between $20 and $40, depending on what the bowling and the charges, plus the stipend and travel for the sponsor. The cost is the same for regionals. Sectionals and regionals are at area bowling alleys. For state, the cost is also the same, over 2 to 3 days, plus lodging. The state tournament is in Rockford this year. The IHSA has sanctioned bowling for many years. They understand and see the value in allowing individuals to participate in state bowling tournaments, even if their schools do not have clubs or teams. Participation benefits both students and the district for many reasons: PR, school spirit and pride, scholarship opportunities, etc. This week, Mainese is staging their V show. My daughter is not here because she is currently working stage crew for the show. I am asking you to give her the chance to show her bowling skills as she is working so others can showcase their performance skills. Thank you.
Thank you. Maria Jankowski.
I'm Maria Jankowski, and the mother of two special kids, which one is in the sophomore version in Mainese, and another one is in the senior. My questions, everybody saying nice thing, and I got 10 questions for today, for just for the education meeting in front of the administration. I tried before for 1.5 years to ask administration questions, but I never had the answers. My first question, I don't know if I have 3 minutes, so I just gonna go with the questions and hopefully somebody's gonna answer me. Why special director? The special education director is not present in the board of education. I can pay for her name paid, but she doesn't have any money to pay. But I would like to, and all special needs parents, have somebody who they can ask questions, because many questions which we're asking, it's not answered by the chairperson at the school. And it's not even on the website. The second question is, has anyone from Board of Education observed or visited special education classes in Memphis? Did you? Anyone? Okay. But nobody else. I would recommend that you go there and observe, because I'm not alone. I asked a few times. I still don't have permission for observation for the first quarter this year and for second quarter. One request I make in October 7th, and another one in 14. The third question is, last year I wanted to have a meeting with the director of special education in St. Casey, and that was happened end of the August in the beginning, just the school and my daughter was starting. But she refused that time, and she took off now. Why? She never gave me a chance to meet with her. Number four, at the beginning of this year, I asked questions by email Mrs. Larson, the Larson who's new director of special education. But she also sent me to Mrs. Diaz, who is chairperson, and Mrs. Carlson, who's assistant of director of special education, which I've tried to work with them since April 2014 when my daughter was still in Gemini, and I don't have any answer from them. And she didn't need me for any questions which I asked her in my email. Why? She's the director of special education. If she don't know what's going on, and she cannot answer the basic questions, is anyone okay? I don't think so. Number five, if anyone from board education knows description of special education classes at Main East, because I tried to ask chairperson from March 7 to 14 before my daughter enrolled to that school, and I still don't have the answer. I just find out in the last final teacher conference in 10/16/15, she's my daughter working in the morning, she's got AM jobs and PM jobs. I didn't find out yet what kind of jobs got. It probably take another 20 or 30 emails before when I get anything, or by mistake, they still just the names. I would like to know the description of special education program at Main East. I would like to know what kind of classes. I would like to know what level of the classes with the special education are, who is the teacher, how many students are, who is a substitute teacher if the teacher is not there, who is teaching the students, and the schedule. Just daily, weekly, regular schedule, which I still don't have it from the yet, and she's second year at the school. Number six, do you know how Dr. Wallace cut the budget from 15 million to 5 million in special education? It was mentioned about that 2-3 months ago on the board education meeting. I was looking for the description. I don't know what he cut. I need the copy of the description. I want to see what he cut for 10 million with the special education budget, because it's a lot of money for special education. And being my daughter in that school, I find out many information about special education classes, which I'm not even allowed to go to the school. I cannot even walk with my daughter to the school. I have to drop her in front of the school and waiting so many minutes last year, at times 20, 25 minutes before my daughter can enter to the school. I give you one example. Do you know, it's number seven, do you know the special education students are being taught by teacher Faith, who doesn't have any knowledge, who's not qualified, and who at times, many times, they don't know what to do with the students. And they still, after 1.5 years, they don't know their needs. I just find out on parents teacher conference, I was allowed to come into the school on 10/16, and I find out my daughter is visually blind, she cannot see in her right side, she was sitting in the wrong place on our class. Our teacher is the same, which was last year. The aide is supposed to know, the chairperson is supposed to know the needs. Nobody knows, she's sitting in the wrong place. If I didn't go to the school, I never would bring her up.
President McGrath?
Yes.
I think to be fair, it's a 3-minute limit, and I'm also concerned.
I have a copy
of what this is. I was
going to
ask if you have a copy.
I would send it to you. I do the email.
Could we make the copy tonight so we would have it?
If you can make a copy?
We have copies.
Okay, so you can do a document. But
we're way beyond the 3 minutes and it's not fair to others.
Just three more questions. Okay. Do you know when I go to the parents advisory with Dr. Presser in the principal meeting last year and this year, I cannot ask any questions during that meeting. I'm not allowed to ask when I go there. Another parents, they can talk about their kids. I cannot, because if I speak, I have to be with them. I don't know why. This is discrimination. I'm the parent. I have to know what my daughter's doing, and I have a right to know what she's doing. Number nine, what about services for special needs students at Main East after school? It's nothing there. I asked chairperson, she told me, on parents teacher conference, Mrs. Diaz, it's none. The special needs students are the same students like everybody else. We're paying the same money, taxpayer money, the same like another parents from the regular students. And number 10. Did you know that Dr. Wallace cut my communication with staff and I cannot enter the school since last year, 10/29? After when my daughter was sick, I dragged her to the school with the permission of the doctor, and they didn't take my daughter because they don't know how to take care of her that time at school. I had to take her after 1 hour, explain, take her home. And because of that, my communication was stuck. I cannot enter to the school. Was sent even in the police department. Dr. Wallace didn't speak to me, didn't have a meeting. I was asking this year for the meeting. He didn't do it. He gave another book with education meeting. Two people was strangers for 2 men. They had right away the cards from Dr. Wallace. When I asked him what is for mine, I didn't get it. He didn't have the meeting, he refused the meeting. Finally, I'm telling the truth, and I'm straightforward. I tell it like it is. It doesn't matter who's sitting here, if Dr. President's here or somebody else is here. I tell it like it is. I'm the mother, I wanted the best for my children. And if somebody didn't tell me when they placed my daughter, when she's sitting quietly here, they placed her in the wrong place, and I found it after 1.5 years. And they're giving me behavior policy signing, and she's holding the paper on the IEP to sign it for me, it's something wrong, and she's not saying it. And one more thing, which I want to say, during the IEP meeting, you're cutting the budget for special education. They got a teacher aide who's teaching them who doesn't have the clue how to teach them. They don't have clue about diagnosis of the kids, and every special, I got 2 of them. Both of them are different. What is working for Jim doesn't work for Tommy. So how are they working with them? How are they working with them? You got in the budget, but
thank you.
It's something wrong.
Thank you very much.
I can only communicate with the chairperson who's not answering my questions regarding my daughter. And I want to say, special needs students, they are students.
Yes.
And they are me, if somebody teaching them. Thank you.
Also, as scholars move through high school, they work increasingly closely with our college counseling department. So that means they're having one-on-one meetings with their parents at our college counselor. They are going on college visits all around the country. And also our seniors are participating in workshops that aim to help them transition to college. And so if you add the value of all of those programs with the small college scholarship and the value of college and alumni programs, that totals to over $47,000 of investment per scholar by the Schubert Foundation. There we go. So I'll share a little bit about some of the successes that our scholars have been having this past year. We will see, hopefully soon, the GPAs that they've been earning are consistently strong. Their weighted GPAs are averaging, there they are, around the 4.3. And so they're really grinding in their rigorous courses at UMass. They're also earning consistently strong ACT scores, which position them to be competitive candidates at top colleges across the country. And we offer an ACT prep course for our juniors. And you can see the pre and actual scores that each year our scholars are seeing significant ACT score growth over the course of the prep course. And when we look at the selectivity of the colleges to which our scholars matriculate, we use a couple different tools. One is Barron's Guide, the second is the Princeton Review. And I won't go into too much detail, but by both measures, our scholars are attending some of the most competitive colleges in the country. And if we specifically turn to the Maine East class of 2015, we can see that they are attending some amazing colleges, including Stanford, MIT, Dartmouth, Middlebury, Claremont McKenna, and the list goes on. And I would draw your attention specifically to a number we're very excited about, which is the amount of non-loan financial aid that has been awarded to our scholars by the institutions that they're attending. So that average number for last year is over $49,000. So that means that over 90% of the financial aid that our scholars are being awarded, they will not have to pay back when they graduate, and they're going to be leaving with very minimal amounts of debt. And this was the first year, last year, that we had a group of Maine East Schubert scholars in college. We had a group of five. That was our first graduating class. And you can see that they had a really successful freshman year with an average 3.52 GPA at colleges like Yale and Bates and Brandeis. And so I wanted to share a few scholar spotlights to make it a little bit more personal. So Zaritza Radanovich is a scholar from the class of 2015. At Maine East, she earned department awards in English and in French. Through the Schuler program, she studied abroad in Ghana. That's where the monkey comes from in her picture. And she is currently a freshman at Middlebury College. Syed Mateen is a scholar from the class of 2014. As a freshman, he took an international relations course at Oakton, sponsored by the Schuler program. For his summer college program, he went to Princeton and took part in the Junior Statesman of America program. He is currently in his second year at Johns Hopkins University and is studying abroad in Japan all year. And then thirdly, Aliana Villalpando, she started off at Maine East a year ahead in math. She spearheaded a battery recycling program and a summer college program. She studied artificial intelligence at Stanford, and she's now at MIT studying aerospace and And so I also would like to take a moment to share with you some of the things that the Schuler program is going to be really focusing on and prioritizing in the year to come. So one of our main goals does relate to recruitment and outreach. And so you can see on this slide that our class size right now is averaging around 12 or 13 scholars per class. And we do want to grow those numbers. And so one thing we know is that we are not recruiting Hispanic students into our program in line with the demographics of Maine East High School. And so that's something we want to focus on, is increasing our outreach and recruitment of Hispanic students. And so we have a couple things already started this year to that end. We're working with people from District 63 to get opportunities to present to parent groups, Spanish-speaking parent groups in Spanish. We're also partnering with Maine East Guidance to run a college planning workshop presentation at Mass Public Library in about a month, and that will be in Spanish English as well. And we also noted, that last year we had slightly fewer applications to the Shuler program overall. And so while we definitely want to focus outreach to Spanish-speaking families and students, we also want to improve our outreach overall to any qualified student to the program. So we want to focus on a couple of different initiatives. Number one, we want to focus on connecting with students and families earlier and more often. So that means earlier in middle school and also in elementary school. And one thing that we're doing already this year to that end is we have started a club at Gemini that focuses on personal development and leadership. This is not a gateway pipeline to the Shuler program in any way. However, it does give us an opportunity to get to know students and families in the community better earlier, and to give them an opportunity to get to know us and to build trust. Because we want, if we're aiming to target scholars who we may have missed otherwise, who are maybe on that academic bubble, we want to be able to leave our academic requirements behind and work with students who might have the potential but maybe aren't performing at that level in seventh grade, get to know students, share information, help them identify their own leadership potential, and possibly have them perhaps increase
their
performance.
So this is like a first opportunity to meet students, and then it will still happen when they're eighth grade and freshman.
Correct. But there's no guarantee just because you're in the club that you're going to be in the Shuler program. The Shuler program, admission to the Shuler program is still dependent on
casting a very wide net for the who's there, and there may be a few students that we haven't been
Right, and I did specifically go into Spanish heritage speaking classes at Gemini to recruit. It's open to anyone, but I specifically went in and presented to those students, and we have a good representation from those classes. So kind of getting to our recruitment goals with that. The second thing we want to focus on is improving our outreach to all middle schools in the area, including Chippewa and Emerson, and we already made some early fall visits to both of those schools with the main guidance department. And thirdly, we want to continue to focus on identifying ninth graders who we may have missed and making sure that we're not missing anybody, and we're extending ninth graders an opportunity to apply if we didn't get them in the first way around. For example, sometimes students transfer into the district. And as always, sorry that this the formatting is difficult to see on this, but this slide is focusing on attrition. And as always, we are working to minimize attrition. And so last year, if I can interpret this very blue slide for you, last year our attrition rate was about 17%. And if you look at the class of 2015 from beginning to end, it was 38%. Both of those numbers are lower than the past year and are on consistent downward trends. And we're going to continue to do everything we can to make sure that attrition continues on that downward trend and that we're retaining as many of our students that we take as possible.
Hey, one quick thing to add there too is, even when a student either drops out or sometimes is dropped from the Shuler program, they continue to support that student in terms of some of the counseling things. So it's not like they no longer get the assistance of the
staff. They still have access to anything that we can provide in-house. So if they want to come for counseling, for tutoring, we're happy to provide that, and we do have students who take advantage of that.
I'm sorry if I missed it, but what were the initial criteria that you identified?
Sure, so there's the academic piece. So students, essentially, there's a number of different data points we look at, and there's no one way to academically qualify or not, but essentially we're looking for students who are going to be able to start Mamies on track to take rigorous courses that are going to make them competitive. Our profile criteria are students must meet at least one, usually more than one, of the following. Come from a low-income background, are of an ethnicity that's underrepresented on college campuses, and or are first generation in the family. Did you have a question?
Your attrition rate at the other schools?
Very comparable. Actually, if the group wasn't there, you would be able to see that it's very comparable. We're about in the middle of the pack. And that should be on your printout.
So, on this right hand side, the class is 2015, you've got attrition, it's only 65,
Right, exactly. So,
I thought that's what I was trying to tell them.
Yes, yeah, we're right in the middle of the pack as far as other Shuler schools and attrition rates. Okay. And so in addition to goals that relate to recruitment and outreach, other things that we're focusing on this year, we want to continue to increasingly become involved with the Mamies community and become a part of that community. And we're eager to be involved in any updates or changes that are related to the district's new college and career initiative. And at this point, I'm happy to take any questions.
I'd just like to comment that I'm so glad that the Shuler Foundation made this partnership, and it's just those two students highlighted.
Yeah.
It's how special it is.
There's 50 of those, right? So we're happy to be there.
Do we apply to be in it, or do they choose the school?
Yeah, so to become a Schuler Partner School, Maine's did apply. There's a process where a school petitions to become a Schuler Partner School.
So even if you had a low percentage of students in the at-risk population, a school could still apply to be in that program? Would that not
You could certainly apply. I think, you know, the person who manages that process is our executive director, Candice Browdy. And I would say that in general, you know, we are looking to partner with schools that have, that are gonna have the population that we're looking for. And so if it's only a very small number of students, and or if those students aren't entering high school in a place where they're gonna be ready to take rigorous courses, then my guess would be that application would probably not be great. So I think you certainly could apply, but I think the more that school can demonstrate that they have the population that we our mission is to serve, the better.
This might be for Mr. Dietz or Dr. Wallace. You mentioned Chippewa, you mentioned Emerson. Do any of the children that attend Iroquois, are they in the Maine population?
They could be.
Because it's from anywhere else. But my point is, Chippewa children go to Maine West, and Emerson children go to Maine South.
So those schools are located in the two optional attendance areas that are shared with the two schools in East.
And Iroquois students can come from anywhere.
Actually,
Iroquois can come from anywhere. So I just thought it was another opportunity.
Right, absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah, because Iroquois, they can come from, they can live anywhere.
They can be. I know that the East West optional attendance area is much closer to 50-50, I mean, it's 55-45 between East and West. So odds are, there could be some kids in Iroquois.
Because as long as you live in this place anywhere, there's no boundaries.
For Iroquois.
It's around school.
Yes.
How do you increase outreach in your group of students? How are you doing that?
So, for example, I talked about the Gemini Club. I talked about some of the earlier visits that we're making to the middle schools other than Gemini, where everybody's coming here anyways. I also sent letters out over the summer to students living in the optional attendance area so that their parents and they can have Maine East and Schuler on their radar before they make their decision about where they're attending. I've presented at a number, and I'm going to present at a number of parent events with District 63, so elementary schools as well as at Gemini. We are working with the libraries over the summer. We have our materials in English and Spanish at Niles Public Library and West Plains Public Library, and I'm working with their teen librarians to connect with students and just get information out. So those are a few of the ways that that are new this year that we're working to increase our outreach.
Do you work with or have community partnerships for the program, like Genesis, Access Genesis?
No.
How do you also reach out to other academic immigrants? Because that's a potential market there too.
Absolutely. And you know, what we have found, this is our sixth year, and when we look at our selection data, what we find is that for whatever reason, the way that we have been doing selection and recruitment and outreach has been working for essentially all other populations of immigrants except Hispanic students. So we have many, many Asian and Caucasian students whose families have recently immigrated into the country. But for some reason, we just have this hole where, you know, Maine is what, about 18% Hispanic, and we have about 5% in the program. And so what we have been doing before seems to be effective in getting information out to other groups. But for whatever reason, it's not effective for that one
specifically. How's that fit to Maine West High School? We should have a nice, strong population of Hispanics too.
We've been trying to get West in there. We just haven't been able to. Schuler so far has not done two schools within the same district, but we've recently had conversations on this, and I'm hopeful that in the future we can get West into the program.
What's the percentage?
And growing.
Zero, zero,
and growing.
2001, Waukegan was our first partner school. And in 2001, it was essentially a scholarship program. So it was really just a scholarship. But what Jackie realized and the program realized in the first few years is that simply awarding a student a scholarship senior year is not enough to ensure that they will then be successful. So that's when the model flipped and the emphasis really became on preparation throughout high school, so that when they are seniors, they're so wonderful that the colleges are going to pay for them to go rather than Jackie's college.
Just in all those schools?
Yes, so right now we're in 12 Chicagoland classes.
Great.
Really
great.
Exhibit at the Niles Library. There's an opening reception this coming Sunday, November 8th, but the exhibit will be in place through November 30th, so I do encourage you to try to get out and see that. It ought to be an interesting event, and Mr. Lee has a tremendous amount of interest in that as well. That's everything for me.
Thank you, Ken. Board members, any updates?
Just want to quickly echo on extending the invitation to everyone else. Members. I'm doing this every year, working with the libraries and museums and so on, remembering the Korean War. As we all know, this is the 65th anniversary from the Korean War time. And at the time, the American veterans who participated in the Korean War, their age is like 17, 18, 19, 20 or so. So now their age is probably 87 to 90.
Attended the Illinois Association. Education Committee met on Tuesday, October 27th at 8 o'clock a.m. And we discussed the driver's education class waiver, which was previously voted on tonight. The second thing that was discussed was the school, summer school calendar and fees. And the board had previously recommended running a cost neutral summer school, which was accomplished. And the recommendation for this year is to maintain the summer school fees and staffing, and that the there'll be two sections running from June 13th to June 30th, 2015, and the second section from July 5th to July 21st, 2015. And each section is 12 days in length. And the board is, or the Education Committee recommends that we approve the calendar at this point. We didn't do that yet, right?
No,
just checking. I thought it was coming up. And then there were some really, I have to commend the education state, Barb DeLarger and her staff, because I was really impressed with the amount of data and the amount of, not just the amount, but the quality of the data that was presented for looking at the AP scores. And all of the, what they did was they took all three sets of scores from the Explore plan and ACT from the class of 2016, in particular, it was the first class part that had the all three of those, or no, the 12th class.
That we
looked at all of the trends across those three tests. So when you're a freshman, sophomore, and a junior, you can look at the growth and then from the past data predict where it was going to be. And our schools are mostly performing better than predicted, which is really good. And in the AP data, that was interesting because it becomes more important as the Illinois law has, it requires now that anybody who gets an AP score of 3 or above has to get college credit. And if you get, so no matter who it is, you have to get college credit. So we, actually all of District 207, we have 78.2% of our scores are 3 or better, which is awesome. That's really
as we've significantly grown the program, nearly doubled it, so that's
And anyway, I'm really I'd like to take some more time later to go over some more of that data with the committee, because there's so much good information there that we can look and share with not only the schools, but maybe the feeder districts as well, because like 62, 63, and 64 should know where our kids are coming in. And I would have found that to be a really good information. So anyway, and the meeting was adjourned at 9:31. Do you have anything to add?
No, I think you covered some of the different points, and it's coming up a little bit later in the program.
So the law was passed by Illinois.
Right.
So any college in Illinois,
right?
Yes.
Right. Right. No. Right. No one. I mean, I wouldn't have to do it.
But they could.
They could. Yeah.
But many
now,
do.
Yeah, many do. But now Illinois has to. Right.
Right.
Excellent.
Great. Thank you very much. Next on the agenda, item 4, monthly status of finances.
In your board packet is the financial report for September. You can see on the revenue side, we were fairly consistent with previous years. On the expense side, we're slightly up, but that has to do with summer construction, because this was a heavier construction year, and summer's the time that happens. Then it'll take each individual fund and go through the revenue expenditures, but there's really no variance between what we are budgeting and how we're reporting the information, and it's trend from previous years. So I will take any questions that anybody has in the September funding.
Thank you very much, Mary. Next, instructional services, advanced placement and EPAS value out of the
I think actually
summarized it pretty well, and that we may have an upcoming ed committee meeting which we can do or into these reports if the board members would like to attend. I'll simply say that the advanced placement data we are sharing for some of the districts, I think that's a very important thing to be elected by other students, how the students are doing. And it's all part of our articulation that our goals and issues are there and access to those courses and how we're hoping to take down some barriers and provide the necessary scaffolding for students to be successful. So this board will see coming from us probably next month, I would imagine, a month after, some information about some of the boot camps that we're going to have for kids so that they're ready for the opportunities that we're hoping to present for them. As far as our EPAS report, which follows the AP report, again, I think Terry did a nice job of summarizing that. Of course, we do have the question mark hanging out there about what the future will hold if the state of Illinois A doesn't fund the ACT test or offer it, whether we continue to do it after this year or not. We'll need to evaluate that, because that is sort of the third leg of our retest longitudinal data benchmarking, and it's been very helpful for us for the past dozen years. So to be discussed more in the future on that as well. I'll entertain any questions or invite you to come to maybe round two of digging deep in a lot of the stats. These are pretty detailed reports. And I think at the next step, maybe we can have some of the questions too.
Any questions at this time?
Good.
Thank you very much. Next item, item 6A, monthly update of summary.
One request is month and a student request.
Okay, and item 6B, the school calendar.
Yes, information for you. The calendar committee has created the tentative calendars for the next three school years. And as you recall from last year, the committee did a lot of work in revising our school calendars. After that, we started a little bit earlier, finished final exams before winter break, and finished the end of the school year before Memorial Day. So these next 3 years mirror that same philosophy. So pretty similar starting dates, ending dates before Memorial Day, first semester end before winter break, to more mirror the college schedule.
And I know we share these with our kind of discussion with our feeder districts so that to the extent possible we're all on the same page.
Correct.
Questions or comments from board members? Thank you very much. Can I have a motion on items, the consent agenda, item 7A through F?
I so move.
Second. Sean, Kim, are there any questions or comments before we vote? Hearing none, give me a quick call for vote, please.
Bessler?
Aye.
Childers?
Aye.
Collins?
Aye.
Lee?
Aye.
Owen?
Aye.
Sullivan?
Aye.
McGrath?
Aye. And a motion on, do we have to put these all together? Yep. Items A through D, Board of Education policy for the future, second read.
Second.
Sure, we have three policies up for revision, and one that's a new policy. All of the revisions have either been recommended by recent updates from the Illinois Association of School Boards or our own legal counsel, who's recommending a change to policy 5229 just to help clarify the language so that there's a little less confusing and can't be misinterpreted. Policy 3245 is a new policy just to clarify for staff members the board's stance on works made for hire, given that we have, with modern technology, some opportunities for staff members to sell lesson plans on the open market, which is something that board policy would not allow if those lessons were created while they were employed as a member of our district. Anybody have any questions?
Yeah, okay. This is the second reading.
This is the second reading, and all of these have been recommended by the policy committee.
Okay. Are there any questions or comments? Hearing none, Jenny, if you'll call the roll, please.
Sullivan.
Aye.
Bowen.
Aye.
Lee.
Aye.
Collins.
Aye.
Childers.
Aye.
Bessler.
Aye.
McGrath.
Aye. Can I have a motion on item 9, summer school calendar and fees?
So moved.
Second. Carl, thank you. I know that Terry reported on this part. Is there anything else that you'd like to add for us?
No, just that we're recommending that we now increase in the fees and that the calendar is so designated here, the 4-day summer work would be approved. I would note that that second session does include a Friday. Most of the other days do not, in order to have the break occur at the end of the 32nd session. So it's the dates as designated here. And then, if you're interested, there's a lot of information, there's financial information as well.
Are there any questions or comments?
So what are the average number of students that the summer school or
well, if you look at the second and third page of the report, you can see the actual enrollments, both academics and athletics, and the numbers of employees employed, number of out-of-district students, and so forth by building, and comparisons between last year and this year. I would say that we've seen sort of a downward trend, a little bit of a downward trend, but for the most part, it's increasing.
Okay. Any other questions?
Can I just mention one thing? You did say this before, but I think it's a really cool idea, and that's that to offer these boot camps as a part of a summer school thing for AP classes. That if you're going to take an AP class, you might not be ready for it, but if you took a boot camp in the summertime, it would really prepare you. And there's been a lot of success on that, like when kids are graduating from college going into grad school, we used to do all boot camps for different topics, and it's really a cool idea, so I'd love to see that implemented.
Tomorrow morning's instructional team, we have some proposals coming forward. Sure, once we lock down to what those will be, we'll do at least an informational memo for the board so they know what's coming up. Those that have credit attached to them, if any, we do those who have to come to the board for approval. But the ones that we've offered in the past have been maybe a few days or a week in one month, but it would be extremely helpful and we kind of track how successful it's been for students.
Thank you. Anything else?
Collins.
Aye.
Lee.
Aye.
Bessler.
Aye.
Owen.
Aye.
Childers.
Aye.
Sullivan. McGrath.
Aye. Can I have a motion with respect to item 10, new course proposals for the 2016-2017 year?
So moved.
I second.
Bart, would you say, is this the second type of thing?
This is the second reading. And if you need a reminder, if you look on the second page, you'll see the chart that summarizes what the new courses are, what courses are that are being dropped, what courses are being revised, and which ones are seeing the added changes. I believe there's some questions in the air, so I'm assuming that these make sense to you, but if you need some questions, I would like to
know. I have a question.
Sure.
Is there a cost increase or decrease for adding courses?
I would say it's going to end up being neutral because we're dropping a number of these courses, some of them are being shortened in length to semesters. And as we invited each of them to make these proposals to the instruction team, that was a question we asked, and there was no request for additional equity.
There was not.
Okay. And so with dropping some, since they didn't ask
probably depends upon
sections of certain things that are coming forward, because a certain course might get multiple sections.
Well, that, I think we're going to start to see, continue to see actually decreases.
Hopefully.
In more people of some, right, we've seen that, maybe out of the,
Probably doesn't mean anything to know, because we've done a better job of tracking our staffing in the spring prior to, and that's really driven by enrollment. So if enrollment drops, we generally would drop. If it goes up, it's really tied to that more than the classes. Because the students, our average student is in like 7 classes, so that stays pretty stable.
Just a quick question on this social science. So we are dropping ACC World History after 1500, also. So and we are adopting a new course, AP World in History. So basically, Main East and Main West will continue keeping this World History after 1500.
Well, the accelerated World History is going to be potentially dropped at West, right, Audrey?
Right.
And
world cultures will be dropped, and the kids will be taking the AP World History.
But that's going to be taught at South.
We aligned that West and South both teach world cultures at regular level at the freshman level. And next year, South will offer, instead of accelerating world history, AP World History as well. So we'll
have some AP opportunity for freshmen.
Correct.
And I also believe all the two principals have kind of lifted over what the AP World History is, particular both the description, the information about. Or
well, the AP curriculum is the AP curriculum, so that's nationwide.
It's approved by the College Board.
So that's a curriculum we have to teach to actually call ourselves the AP course. And that's available to just about anyone who wants to take it.
This is on Chromebook, or is it, do we have this in our book too? Textbook?
I'm not sure about the Texas program yet. I'll be looking at.
We're looking for a new textbook as well.
Yeah.
Textbook. Is it also kind of requested to see a pick of the pen when time comes for this particular AP World History that we have?
Yeah,
all of the textbooks
on for
you.
Board, yeah.
Your textbook.
Yeah. Just like we do at any
I will be very interested to pick up the pictures and more pieces.
Are there any other questions about the court proposals? Hearing none, if you want to take
Owen?
Aye.
Collins?
Aye.
Lee?
Aye.
Childers?
Aye.
Sullivan?
Aye.
Bessler?
Aye.
McGrath?
Aye. Can I have a motion with respect to item 11, the 2015 tax levy?
Moved.
Mary.
But I do want to point out, as Member Sullivan pointed out, it's a 2.94% increase, but it's also nice to point out that it's a 2.1% increase on existing property owners. The difference between the 2.1 and the 2.9 is new properties coming onto the tax roll. That's the amount that we are levying. What actual new properties come onto the tax roll is what we will be able to access. We will file the notification, even though we're not required to do the truth in taxation, by publishing it in the paper to give the community an opportunity to address the board on the tax levy, and we will have it on the December board meeting agenda for adoption so that we can file it by the last Tuesday in December.
Okay. We have a public hearing on before the next board meeting.
On December 7th.
I'm sorry, what are we approving? If we're approving the levy tonight,
why did you approve it in tentative form to give the community an opportunity to take a look at it, and then it'll
there'll
be
a second vote.
Yes.
And whenever you talk about if we don't levy, we won't get the benefit of new properties, you mean for that year only?
No, forever. So
I don't understand that.
So if a new property comes on and you don't levy enough tax dollars to spread that tax burden to that property, it just has an effect of reducing the tax burden on all properties. And with the CPI that we're capped at, which is 0.8%, I don't think that we can afford to miss any tax dollars on that new property. So as you can see in the levying, we are levying $50 million of new property, but we're only anticipating that we'll get $15 million of new property. But if we don't get $50 million, it's not that tax burden is not spread amongst the remaining taxpayers. We just don't have the ability to gain tax dollars on any property we don't receive.
I understand that.
But because the levy sets the base for each future year, if you not levied enough dollars to your maximum for that base on the new property, you don't, that's your new base forever. That's why you lose that ability every year. Does that make more sense? Okay.
No.
So let's say.
But I think at another time. I've tried to understand it. And I just don't get it.
Okay. Mary, quickly, I'm in the same situation as the board member, Mary Cook. And I was wondering if you can request a special education course or training for
absolutely. I am happy to sit down with either of you, both of you, at the same time for the next board meeting and walk you through it.
It's all courtesy. I can move the translator.
Yes.
Yes. Another question.
Can I try to translate for you?
Sure.
It's for you, the housing market. It's just like if you go out and get your mortgage and you've got a mortgage, and then you turn around and you pay a little bit of interest. So if you turn on and borrow $100 and I charge you 4% interest, you're going to be paid back $104, so to speak. If I don't charge you that 4%, but I charge it to you only in the second year, well, instead of getting $109.20, you're going to be back at $104. You're missing that turnaround in payment. Once you fail to turn around and charge that interest for that year, you never recover it again because you can't go back and suddenly charge 8% because we have a tax cap. That's the closest I can get is, it's a compounding effect, and when she says you miss it forever, what you miss is the opportunity to recover that money that you passed.
From then, but you are able to get more.
Well, I'm able to charge 4% the following year,
right?
For example, but I can't come back and charge you 8%. I'll never recover what I didn't
that
charge
one
this year.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why she says it's forever.
So if you, so the $50 million thing, so if it's new properties, how do you figure out like new properties? You go and look at
so what I do is I look at our trend analysis and then it's kind of a guess. So why it's a guess, which is why I guess high. I levy for $50 million. I think based on our trend analysis that it's going to be about 15, even with the new parcels coming on board, because for many years that has been on a downward trend, and that actually at $15 million is slightly higher a projection than we received last year.
But I guess I was thinking that you would look at, you know, like there's a new development, like if you look at the Park Ridge city,
you'd say that would be like a permit, right? But most of the new property comes in on improvements to existing houses, which is something that
that's considered new property?
Yes.
I was thinking like it was new developments.
Yeah, so if
well,
you
that too
is new property.
So I mean, that would be the biggest chunk,
right? If you look at Park Ridge, we have one in Des Plaines.
Well, you've got a lot of new construction, not $50 million.
Oh, that would be
the
right
number, right? Okay.
Are there any other questions?
Would the community would clarify that the actual levy is 2.914% instead of 2.94?
We publish what we actually levy, which is the 2.94. At the public hearing, we always explain there's a difference between what we are levying for and what we believe the most likely amount of money that we will get.
Any other questions?
No, I think it just kind of all started because we're really not approving the levy. We're approving
a levy in tentative form.
Okay. for review and comment by the public. Mm-hmm. Ready? Judy, take the roll, please. Lee?
Yeah.
Childers?
Aye.
Bessler?
Aye.
Sullivan?
Aye.
Owen?
Aye.
Collins?
Aye.
LeBrand?
Aye.
Can I have a motion with respect to item 12, capital projects?
I move.
Thank you. Mary?
The summer projects for 2016, as Board Member Bessler pointed out, run the gamut between flooring and doors and lightning detection systems and paving and roofing. We're anticipating doing about $3.7 million worth of work.
kind of bidding in a favorable bidding environment, which is our hope to get the best price on them. But you'll see these projects, many of them come back to the board in the form of a bid.
So in doing this process of these projects, would be any new opportunity vendors could participate, contribute, minority vendors?
So we are required by law when we bid a project to take the lowest responsible bidder. We then ask those vendors if they're minority owned, but that is an after the fact thing by Illinois law that we're required to do. We're not allowed to have that influence our decision on who to award the contracts to. Similarly, when those projects are below the bid threshold, we always go with the lowest responsible quote because it's our duty to make sure that we can stretch the taxpayer dollars the farthest. We always look for minority and local businesses to get quotes from because that's our preference, but we always go with the lowest responsible quote or bid.
I know we are doing a nice job on it, but how do we continue to reach out to the new potential those vendors or new vendors who may qualify and would like to participate, but because of the
isn't a public notice? You think there's public notice, Jim?
Yes. We're required to do that.
We do.
Where is it posted?
We post it in newspaper of general circulation. We generally go with Journal and Topics or the Daily Herald. So, but there are, how vendors really get is their subscription services that go through all the newspapers and they look for keywords and then companies buy that subscription services so they get all bids for HVAC equipment. So then they'll get all of those.
Reading every paper every day.
Yes. Yeah, we also, it's on our webpage. We, in a variety of places.
Well, in my experience, that's where we get posted.
Sure, because they're looking to work with the school.
But overall, we are not having a difficulty finding those vendors. Generally.
Look, the interesting thing is with the economy coming back, our quotes have gone up higher. A lot of contractors are actually too busy to bid, which helps drive the prices up even more. So we're doing everything we can to turn around and beat the bushes to get as many vendors out there to bid as we can.
You're talking about Triton?
I'm talking government entities.
So, but the ones, yeah, here.
Yeah, like for instance, on the Main West project, we noted subcontractors that we felt did a particularly good job.
Previously.
Well, on that project, so for like concrete and paving, the concrete paving vendor was very good. So we will make sure that when we have the bid for concrete and paving, because this is a contractor we've never worked with before, that he will get a copy of that bid because we were pleased with his performance on another job.
What happens if somebody that you do it does a really good job, but they come in with a bid that's, I don't know, $1,000 more? You just take the lowest bid.
By law.
So even if it, and so even if they have a previous relationship, there's no points or anything that you get for that.
But okay, Mary, as I recommended before, is it possible our district could offer some kind of vendor relation, contract informational gathering, seminar, workshops, or some kind of opportunity for the new potential vendors to get to know about our district contracting services? How to bid, how to participate in this process, or getting those information in general. Possibly other small minority vendors who would like to participate but not able to get that information.
My personal opinion would be that the best way to do it would be if you were to host something at an off-site location, not here, for example, the library, whether it be Niles or Park Ridge, and you could invite a number of governmental entities because while 207 bids, so does 62, 63, 64, Niles, Park Ridge, the park districts in both of those towns, and you have them come in and have tables there with information. But the point is that the concept of how to bid is an educational function, not necessarily the function of the governmental entities. And so I think you should actually offer something and invite people to participate. But it's awkward for us to turn around and look like we're targeting individual vendors, possibly to the exclusion of others. Whereas if you were to host it at an offsite location, you invited the district to come, even Triton College, I'd probably send somebody over there to turn around and have a table to give information out about our bidding processes.
So we held a symposium a few years ago, and we just happened to have one vendor show up. But it just, you know, as Mary said, unlike, I think the city of Chicago maybe has set aside, we are not allowed to do that. We have to really is the lowest responsible bidder.
Maybe possibly this, like, city of maybe City of Dust Springs, City of Park Ridge, maybe Economic Development Commission or departments, maybe they can kind of initiate it and maybe host like such an event as a co-host possibly.
Any other questions at this time? Comments? Okay, Jenny, could you take the roll, please?
Collins?
Aye.
Bowen?
Aye.
Lee?
Aye.
Bessler?
Aye.
Sullivan?
Aye.
Childers?
Aye.
McGrath?
Aye. A motion with respect to item 13, approval of the 2015-2016 tuition cost per pupil.
I so move.
Sorry. Are there any questions or comments?
There's only one student that's paying?
One.
Right now.
Right now. If there's somebody that comes in second semester, this sets the tuition amount for any student.
How much is it normally? How many students normally?
We've had as high as 4 or 5, but it's
seven
probably
was our largest a couple of years ago.
Yeah, so the range has probably been 1 to 7. We've always had at least one. Just not just a handful.
And is the student at the South Asian?
Yes. I'm not sure what this one is, but yeah, okay.
It's the same tuition for all three?
Yeah, oh yes.
It is a calculation done based on our financials for the previous fiscal year divided by the average daily attendance of our students. So it is a state formula.
Right.
And you're required to charge tuition for an out-of-district student attending your schools if you allow that, and we do, so we're required to do it.
So are we charging students from out of state? You're charging this amount?
Out of district. Most of them are just local, but they, yes.
So let's say international students with the guard view who reside in our districts, how that fits?
With the guardian in our district, they are our district. They would
qualify for a resident.
The brand was some kind of a court paper.
Yes, they would have to verify all that. Yes.
Right.
Any other questions? Bring that up, call roll, please.
Lee?
Aye.
Bessler?
Aye.
Collins?
Aye.
Owen?
Aye.
Childers?
Aye.
Sullivan?
Aye.
McGrath?
Aye.
Can I have a motion with respect to item 14, the request for waivers? These are the two waivers that were discussed in the public hearings prior to the board meeting.
So moved.
14A and B.
Mary?
I move for both.
Okay.
Second.
All right, thank you. Are there any questions or comments? None, if you call the roll.
Very quickly. So for example, the driver education fee. So actually we are charging the student about 350 something cost, right?
Right?
So which means we as a district are responsible for approximately how much about gross?
Close to $800.
$800. So. Okay. And then where is the $800 the budgets are coming from? What kind of revenue?
Ed fund.
Ed fund.
Fund.
Yes. Lobby for that.
And we are good. That's
yes.
The question.
Okay. Any other questions?
These are what we've been teaching drivers at for decades. So it's been a function of the District 07 budget, as are almost every item has been in our budget for decades. And it's just, this is a yearly, actually a 5-year thing that we have to do on the waiver for the drivers.
The waiver is different than the approval of the fees for the drivers,
right,
which comes
yes
at another time. This
right
is just saying we can charge more than the state mandated
$50.
But I see many of the students are going to the private because they're trying to save the time and anything else. But they also pay approximately about $350, $400.
That's going up.
No,
it's more like $450 to $500 now.
Yeah. So we're still
It used to be 400, like 8 years ago. Now it's more like 500.
But I've been hearing from the students too, is that as much as they want to take these driving courses from the school, it's just that they have to wait in a long lines or not much of an opportunity.
If they turn 16 later.
They're in a hurry.
That's been true.
Yeah. Wow. Most of the, I'll tell you why they take the private school.
That hasn't changed either.
The reason kids go to the private school is because they're in a hurry.
Yes.
The minute they turn 16, they want that license. They don't want to wait for Maine South to offer that course and be in the class. And they could turn 16 in the middle of the class and then they can't get their license. So if they're at the private school, they're only doing that for a month. I think, isn't it? And so then they get their licenses turned as soon as they get 16. And that is the major reason, because kids are in a hurry.
Yeah.
But I'd like to state for the record that no private driving school teaches your students better.
That's absolutely true. My kids.
And so, all of my children come through. Even my son has already turned 16. He's taking it here next spring because he's going to take it from Maine South because it's the best place to learn.
It is the best place.
Okay.
With that, I'll call the question.
Thank you. We're ready for the question. Jenny, if you'll call the roll, please.
Childers?
Aye.
Owen?
Aye.
Sullivan?
Aye.
Lee?
Aye.
Collins?
Aye.
Bessler?
Aye.
LeBrand?
Aye. Okay. So can we have a motion with respect to items 15A and B? That's the agreement with Northwest Orthopedics and Sports Medicine and the Plus Satellite Agreement. Both of these are. Are there any questions or comments on these contracts? Hearing none, take a roll, please.
Sullivan?
Aye.
Owen?
Aye.
Lee?
Aye.
Collins?
Aye.
Childers?
Aye.
Bessler?
Aye.
LeBrand?
Aye. Next up is calendar items. Any additions or changes here? We are in school on Veterans Day.
Yes.
So this is part of the calendar change.
Part of the calendar change, and we will. We've got trade-offs. It was important, I think, in these numbers to have Columbus Day off, a lot of college business that day. We are having very nice veterans commemorative ceremonies in each of the buildings on Veterans Day, including commemoration of the main flyer mementos that we have in each one of the buildings.
Make a correction to the calendar as published here. Board meeting is actually going to be December 7th, 2015. And the law of public hearing.
It is December 7th?
Yes, that's
the second. It's not a Monday.
It's the first Monday in December.
7th.
It's a typo.
Bessler?
Aye.
Childers?
Aye.
Collins?
Here.
Lee?
Aye.
Owen?
Aye.
Sullivan? McGrath?
Aye. Can I have a motion with respect to item 20A and B, the personnel action?
Second.
Thank you. Are you ready for the roll?
Sullivan?
Aye.
Owen?
Aye.
Lee?
Aye.
Collins?
Aye.
Childers?
Aye.
Bessler?
Aye.
LeBrand?
Aye. Any other items?
Can I ask a question? As far as procedural, if someone gave me a policy to look at, do I have to mention it here to send it to a policy committee?
Are you asking for something about a policy?
Yeah, I mean, it's a policy about days off, emergency days off.
You want the policy committee to talk about something?
So is that something you just send it to, or you bring it up here and then?
I would send it to Greg.
Send it to Greg, for, depending on who gave you the policy, there may be perfectly legal reasons that our policy is written the way it is, we need to.
That would answer the question.
And Greg can answer that question.
Okay.
Someone may want us to change our policy, but there may be legal reasons why we can't.
But I just, I didn't know the procedural way to do it, so you just.
Greg is a policy guy.
Let me know which one they have questions about, or.
Okay.
A motion to approve the closed session minutes for October 5th.
Take your pick. You have agreement.
And, could you take a roll, please?
Collins?
Aye.
Owen?
Aye.
Gensler?
Aye.
Childers?
Aye.
Lee?
Aye.
Sullivan? McGrath?
A motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.